Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. It's finally time to share an update on the progress of my keyboard design. As you can see, I have a physical prototype that I 3D printed, and I learned that my design has some issues that need to be resolved. So today, I'll be reviewing the current design with you and the changes that I'm planning on making for the next version. And really quickly, remember to like and subscribe to help support the channel. I'm gonna do my best to make this keyboard project a success, and I hope you'll enjoy the series. Okay, now let's take a look at my prototype. I already have a video of my unboxing and immediate impressions, so you can check that out if you're interested. But to summarize, I had these parts 3D printed from PCBway, and they took about a week to get to me. To be clear, this video is not sponsored by PCBway. I paid for all their services with my own money. Here is a summary of all the parts I ordered with a final price of $250. I don't have any context as to whether this was a good value or not, so let me know in the comments. The majority of the cost is from the larger and denser parts, specifically the bottom case and wrist rest. I didn't see any option to edit the infill density of my prints, so they're pretty much all using whatever settings were default. The main point of this prototype is to test the physical tolerances, dimensions, and practicality of the board in its current state. I found that the quality of the prints is nice and smooth, but because they're all white, it's a little hard to see the finer details on camera. For that reason, I decided to paint the parts so you can see them better and have a clear view of how everything fits. I've been using Tamiya model spray cans lately because their coats are thin and easy to control. I also used some automotive clear coat to finish. After painting, we can attempt the assembly of the board. My design uses two screw sizes, which you can easily order from McMaster. I didn't know what McMaster was before this project, but it's basically the Amazon.com of hardware. I chose Phillips head screws instead of typical hex screws because people more commonly own Phillips screwdrivers. And I wanted to keep it as accessible as possible. The Tex weight pieces are screwed into the wrist rest and bottom case to hold them in place. I have three PCBs that I'm testing with my case. The DZ65 from KBD Fans, Instant65 from Canon Keys, and BT65. Unfortunately, my plate was not a compatible size with the PCBs. As you can see, there is a large bow when the two ends are installed, which makes the plate design a failure. I tried a couple of things to make it work with the PCBs, but I was unsuccessful. I'm going to have to double check the 3D model of the plate in accordance with Cherry's mechanical keyboard standards. My first inspection showed that everything should have fit properly, so the problem may be due to warping of the 3D print. I'm going to double check it first, and if everything looks okay, I'll order a metal plate instead, which shouldn't have any warping issues. Regardless, for the sake of the video, I decided to install some switches into the plate and continue assembly without a PCB. My keyboard is top mount, so the plate screws into the top case. And then it's easily attached to the bottom case. The four small notches ensure perfect alignment every time. I decided not to screw it completely together so I can still access the inside, but I threw some keycaps on to give it a complete visual. I'm glad that I decided to make this prototype instead of jumping straight into a CNC'd product because there are a number of alterations that I would like to make. Aside from double checking the measurements of the plate, the first change is ensuring compatibility with multiple PCBs. Because I myself am not designing the PCB for this keyboard, I want it to be compatible with as many pre-existing 65% PCBs as possible, within reason. If you notice on my design, I have two blockers around the aero cluster. I personally like this look, but this layout is incompatible with the DZ65. Instead of two keys next to the spacebar, it has three that connect the entire bottom row. Basically, I found that there are multiple layouts for the bottom row, which I didn't anticipate. My layout works with the Instant65, but not the DZ65, which I don't like. I'm planning on removing the blockers entirely and having a plate with a universal bottom row layout. Again, this choice is to ensure wide compatibility with multiple PCBs. I'm also thinking of enlarging the USB-C port cutout. I'm sure that there are different PCBs that I can't anticipate that may have a slight variance in the placement of their connectors. Some may be slightly to the left or the right, but even a slight misalignment would mean incompatibility. To fix that, if I enlarge the cutout hole to be the larger area, or if I at least widen it, I can better account for that variance. And this is the direction I would prefer to go. If you disagree with any of these decisions or have additional feedback, please let me know in the comments. Apart from the 3D printed keyboard, I had this additional cube CNC milled so I can test a few more things. Because 3D printing and CNC milling are different manufacturing processes, it's safe to assume that their capabilities are different. This cube has a few different tests on it. There's a hole at the top and extrusion at the bottom so I can measure tolerances. Also, there's an engraving to test the engraving depth and 3 threaded screw holes on the side. One important thing I noticed was that the hole at the top has rounded corners, even though I designed it with sharp ones. This is actually a big problem because the corners may interfere with the object I'm trying to insert. I'll try to put an example on the screen of what I mean. Because of this, I'm going to have to change the design of my letters to include rounded corners so they can fit into their designated cutouts perfectly. Speaking of which, I'm still on the fence about the final name for this keyboard. I have a couple of options that I'm considering, and if you have any suggestions for a name, feel free to let me know. Taking a look at my original roadmap for this project, we are past the second step and I'm now moving on to step 3. I'll make the changes I discussed earlier and then the design will be complete. From there, I'll manufacture the first two in metal. One will be for me to keep and the other will be used in an Animec build. Then it will be followed by an interest check and group buy, which will be when you guys will have an opportunity to purchase the board. Thank you guys so much for supporting my channel and this project. Remember to subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you in the next one.